including the National Lawyers Guild. And Honey asked me to say a few words, and I think I'm going to say basically the same thing that I usually say, which is to try and put the surveillance that we're under these days into a little bit more of a context. Growing up in the United States, we hear over and over again, you live in a free country. And in an absolute sense, that's never really been true, has it? If you go back in history, you remember the Palmer Raids in the 1910s, 1920s, where people were arrested for having left-wing political views. The McCarthy period, in which people were blacklisted for being communists. Pardon me?
Haymarket?
Yes, the Haymarket riot incident, anyway, in which people were hanged, basically, for being labor organizers on trumped-up charges. A lot of what we think of as the freedoms that we have in the United States are relatively recent phenomena. A lot of the court protections that we have are the developments of court decisions that took place in the 1950s and 1960s and 1970s, the period of the so-called Warren Court. And what we're seeing, in my opinion, is we're seeing a rolling back of those protections. And those protections have never been extended to everybody, of course. The Black Panthers knew very well the limits of American freedom, the number then that were simply murdered by police in Oakland or Chicago or wherever else. But for a certain set of American society, there was a great deal of liberty that was afforded for that time. And we saw the movement away from that, beginning more than anything with people with Muslim people or people of Arabic descent who've been targeted under this rubric of being terrorists. And I want to say a little bit about that because since the 9/11 attacks in the United States, there have been something like 500 terrorist busts by the Federal Bureau of Investigation. Over 99% of those arrests involved a situation in which basically the FBI had set someone up, had induced somebody to attempt to purchase explosives or something of that sort, and then had arrested them for purchasing it. The typical target of these busts would be a very young person from an immigrant family who's angry at U.S. foreign policy and is talking online, to be contacted by somebody who says, oh yeah, do you mean all that? Are you going to do something about it? And so on. And eventually that person ends up going to prison. Recently we had one case that was a little bit different that was in the news. A middle-aged white man with a right-wing political bent, but basically the same thing had taken place. He was talking tough online. He was contacted by some FBI informants who said, do you really mean all this? And he ends up arrested when they convince him to buy some explosives from them. So this is the terror that we're being asked, or that is being used to justify what's taking place, is in many cases, for the most part, is mythical. There are very occasional terror attacks. There's the Boston bombing, which may have been a terror attack, although the motivations of the perpetrators aren't altogether clear. But most of what is sold to us as terror attacks is nothing of the sort. In fact, the odds of you dying in a terrorist attack are virtually nil. You're 8 times as likely to be killed by a policeman as you are by a terrorist. You're much more likely to die from lightning strikes. I think actually probably shark deaths are at least as common as terrorist deaths in the United States. So it's not something that is actually an ongoing problem in the United States, but nevertheless it is the driver of these changes in laws. And getting back, because I guess I've gone on a detour, to the subject of who it started with, it started, as I think most of us know, with Muslims and people of Arabic descent. And we saw that very clearly in Dallas with the Holy Land Foundation. The Holy Land Foundation was a group of people which was collecting aid for Palestinians. Now, the situation of people living in Palestine is very terrible. They're under a blockade of most types, you know, all kinds of things. They're not allowed into the country by the Israeli government. The economy has virtually come to a halt. And so the Holy Land Foundation was collecting such things as food, diapers, etc., to provide aid to Palestinians. And they were arrested, they were charged under terror laws, and a number of them are now in prison serving effectively life sentences. These are people who were purchasing diapers, purchasing food. They didn't purchase a bomb, they didn't set off a bomb, they had no plans to do anything of the sort. There's no way that you can twist the English word terrorist broad enough to cover them. But nevertheless, under the rubric of the war on terror, they were locked up for the rest of their life, it now appears. So that's spread now, and we're seeing it applying to that sort of tactic, applying to more and more people. Now applied to ecologists or environmentalists, many of whom are being. We're seeing it applied. applied to energy services, such as people in the Northwest who were down for months for the grand jury investigation, and the grand jury had been impaneled to investigate the breaking of some windows. So this is a setback from these rights that we were guaranteed, or that we grew up thinking that we had been guaranteed. And I want you to think about this, though. They didn't lock the Holy Land Foundation up because the Holy Land Foundation was going to kill somebody. They didn't impanel a grand jury in the Northwest to investigate some broken windows because nobody would bother. Nobody impaneled a grand jury over some broken glass. Colossal waste of resources. So why is this being done? There's all these legal justifications. They can say, well, they've broken off glass and it's a felony. They can say the Holy Land Foundation, well, they had some dealings with some people in the Palestinian government that are also in Hamas, so that's going to make a terror connection. They can come up with all these legal justifications, but none of them can possibly serve as an explanation for the oppression and simply the direction of resources to stopping basically activist people. So what is the real reason? And I put it to you that the real reason is that they're scared. They're scared of the Holy Land Foundation. They're scared of the environmentalists. They're scared of little anarchist groups in the Northwest. They're not scared because these groups are going to kill somebody. They never have, and they're not going to. They're not scared because these groups are so big. They're scared because we live in a country where the policy is in one direction and the people are in another, where the disconnect between the needs of the people and the decisions of the government grows bigger and bigger every year, and we are waiting for a break to take place, and they know it's going to, and that's why they're spending so much time and so much energy chasing down activists of every stripe, imprisoning activists on bogus charges and so on, because as small as that may be now, as small as this protest may be today, it has the potential to get very, very big, and if it didn't, they wouldn't bother policing it the way that they've been doing. Thank you.
Thank you, Dan.
Thank you, Dan.